They're not delusional. They don't really believe they are pregnant.
Woman who would kill for a baby. And later.
They bought brand new sofas, a stove, curtains, railers.
A checkpoint probe with a happy ending.
If you've never heard the term Caesarian kidnapping before, that's about to change. This is Checkpoint, and I'm Nkepile Mabuse. In 2000, a pregnant teenager was kidnapped, her stomach cut open, and her baby stolen from her womb. This happened in Delft, Cape Town. At the time, it seemed like a bizarre crime. But since then, two more cases of a similar nature have surfaced right here in Gauteng. Investigators are reluctant to say this type of crime is on the increase. But it has a name, and its perpetrators have a desperate need.
She's accused of committing an unspeakable crime. But this is no ordinary murder case. Police say in July last year, 24-year-old Ntombincane Magulana stole a baby from its mother's womb before setting the woman alight and then claiming the child as her own. It's a rare and macabre crime referred to as caesarean kidnapping.
Essentially, caesarean kidnapping is when a suspect approaches a pregnant woman, lures them away, and then literally using a very primitive item such as scissors, knives, even keys in some instances, cut out the child and the person then takes the child away and keeps the child as their own.
The first known case of this nature was recorded nearly 40 years ago in Pennsylvania, Philadelphia. Since then, more than 20 women from the United States have been convicted of the crime. Perpetrators of caesarean kidnapping are said to be cold, calculating, and extremely self-centered. All of them desperate to become mothers at any cost. Shuta Ngongo shows us pictures of the woman of his dreams. He and his wife Gabisile were excitedly awaiting their very first girl child before their plans were shattered by what police believe was a double murder. Shooter says this woman in black, who was their neighbor at the time, claimed she too was pregnant. He says she befriended his unemployed wife with the promise of introducing her to a microlender from whom they could both borrow money to raise their children. On the 1st of August, Shooter was brought to this open field, less than a kilometer from his home, to identify a badly burnt body.
I'm going to go to the house.
Her empty womb and placenta would later help detectives piece together what they believe is the tragic tale of a brutal birth and devastating death. In court, with shooter looking on, investigating officer Sanibor Ngema testified that Ntombengane faked a pregnancy for 8 months and then abducted Gabisile with the sole purpose of stealing her child and keeping it as her own.
Now, Warrant Officer Ngema, between December 2012 and July 2013, what other things or acts did the accused do to strengthen this simulation that she was pregnant?
Ngema successfully opposed bail by arguing that this is a case of premeditated murder, long in the planning and executed on July 31st. He says the deceased was seen leaving from this house with the accused, but that she returned alone, holding a baby. The child was dead. A search for Gabisile ensued. In the meantime, the accused took the dead baby to hospital.
How did the accused ended up at the hospital that evening?
She allegedly refused to be examined by the doctor until the police were called. It was only then discovered that she was never pregnant. She was immediately arrested and, according to the police, later admitted that the child was not hers. She allegedly pointed the finger at a prophet living in this house, saying it was the prophet and two men who stabbed the victim in the neck before removing the child from its mother's womb. She told police that the prophet then instructed her to take the dead baby to the hospital and swap it for a live one. In the gallery, the prophet's sister listened attentively as this version was rubbished by an autopsy report which points to possible strangulation. No stab wounds were found on the victim's body. Ngema testified that no trace of blood was found at the prophet's home either. While no one witnessed Gabisile's death, Ntombengane's version of how she got hold of the child is refuted by state witnesses and forensic evidence. Shooter says preliminary tests have confirmed that the baby belonged to his wife. The circumstances surrounding some 25 documented cases of caesarean kidnapping around the world are very similar.
They're not delusional. They don't really believe they are pregnant. What we more likely find is that there's issues of personality. They have a particular personality structure, perhaps very dependent in nature. They need to cement a relationship with their partner that might be failing or that they feel might be in jeopardy if they don't have a child or that individual, and then set out to use this as a mechanism. Other ones sometimes actually feel the sense of the rewards that you get from being pregnant. I mean, people treat you obviously very specially when you're pregnant. New mothers, they get a lot of attention. So it's almost in some ways the child or the pregnancy or the faked pregnancy is a mechanism by which to get treated in a certain way by society.
A 26-year-old woman charged with attempted murder and baby snatching in Cape Town has been sent to a psychiatric hospital for evaluation. But first, Lazarine Minot appeared briefly in the Mitchells Plain Magistrates Court this morning. Minot allegedly used a bread knife and scissors to cut open the stomach of a pregnant 16-year-old to steal a baby.
Incidents of caesarean kidnapping in South Africa first emerged in 2000, a finding that the suspect was mentally unfit to stand trial in that case sparked anger and calls for revenge.
She butchered my daughter, she cut my daughter open with a scissor and a knife. I mean, she's a murderer. She's a bloody murderer. I think she's a murderer.
My daughter is here. 11 years later, Loretta Cook, seen here in blue, became South Africa's second known caesarean kidnapping suspect. During a recent court appearance, she successfully evaded our camera. She too is accused of faking a pregnancy and keeping up the pretense at home, work, and on Facebook. With only a few weeks to go, she wrote 2 months before her arrest, "Then I'll be holding my precious baby in my arms, but my feet can't take it anymore. No more." She even posted a letter to her unborn child. The state will argue that the 30-year-old woman was never pregnant and that she lured her expectant neighbor to her home in Randfontein, Johannesburg, with the promise of a pram. It is here that she's alleged to have cut open the woman's uterus with a razor and removing her baby. The mother died instantly. Her body was allegedly found in a dustbin at Loretta's home. The child miraculously survived. It is a crime that shatters lives, both physically and psychologically. Shooter's other children were taken away by relatives after their mother's death. This once proud husband and father says he has lost everything that was precious to him.
3 weeks ago, we brought you the story of baby Lerato, a rape victim whose mother was promised assistance by a Johannesburg businessman, only to be given the runaround. When she approached us, she was angry, broken, and she felt betrayed. Today, we're happy to report that since we broadcast the story, she not only got assistance from the people who initially offered, viewers also came to the party.
Brand new furniture, freshly painted walls, toys, a cot, curtains, and monthly groceries. This is the list of goods baby Lerato's mother now has after Checkpoint highlighted her plight 3 weeks ago.
How do I feel about the whole thing? I feel very, 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 very happy.
In early April, she was a hurt and broken woman. At 6 weeks old, her baby had become one of the country's youngest rape survivors. South Africans expressed shock and some offered help. A concert was held in Kimberley. An organizer, Mbuso Tabete, pledged to use some of the proceeds to provide baby Lerato with basic needs. But 4 months went by with Mbuso having delivered nothing but broken promises. When Checkpoint interviewed baby Lerato's mother, she told us Mbuso was no longer taking her calls. We tried to get to the bottom of the matter, but Mbuso kept on making more promises. A week after we aired this story, he finally delivered.
Checkpoint really helped me to track him down, and I must say that at least he has come. And the special part about the thing, he came on my child's 6-month birthday, and he bought a cake.
paint may seem an odd contribution, but to this family, it has made a huge difference.
What I really like about him painting the house is like gave it a fresh start. You know, when you like do a renovation, you are moving on, you are entering into new and beautiful things, and I was quite happy, I must say. I enjoyed myself yesterday with them. And
she's particularly excited about the new environment that has been created for her daughter.
The house has space now. He made it so, to be child-friendly, I must say. So my child can move around and play inside the room, very nice. I never dreamed of my child having a court. I've only seen that in white areas, but not here. So I'm so happy.
Baby Lerato is still recovering, and she will forever need medical and psychological support. Following our initial program, Checkpoint viewers also came forward offering assistance.
With all that is said and done, with all the pain, the hurt, I must say, through trials and tribulations, God is there. There is light at the end of the tunnel. There is hope. There are people who are willing to help you. But you must also know that you must help yourself also, because you must forgive him. Your heart must be pure.
Thanks again to all of you who made contributions to Baby Lerato. After the break, 20 years of democracy. Who's celebrating and who's not? For decades, their human rights were trampled on. And then, 20 years ago, freedom came. But as we all mark this significant milestone, let's spare a thought for the elderly in Perdekop, who say they stare death in the face, having lost all hope of enjoying the fruits of freedom.
Perched on a peak in Mpumalanga, some 40 kilometers from Standerton, is the little town of Perdekop. During the Second Boer War, this hill was a lookout point for the British monitoring Boer activity. Today, ANC posters line the streets, and like many towns around the country, the local government here can list some significant achievements 20 years into democracy.
We have built houses here. Perdekop, there were only 100 houses here in Perdekop. Now we have many houses around. Decent houses. And then we have built a school. This area had a very small school. We have built a double-story school that you have seen on the other side. There is a clinic, best clinic here. We have a library. We have just opened a library. We have a daycare centers. We have paved the streets, street lights in streets. Everyone has got water here.
But Alfred Zwane is not impressed by any of it. At 78 years of age, he says he's still waiting for promises made by Nelson Mandela to be fulfilled. For years, Alfred and his octogenarian wife, Jadeda, lived on a farm where they worked. When they retired, they moved into a shack, and then 10 years ago, into these mud huts. They say in the last decade, their living conditions have deteriorated. Their doors are falling apart, and using a pit toilet at their age has become unbearable, they tell us. The floors are constantly damp, and the roof is caving in. The Zwanes now believe voting is a waste of time.
Benza.
Checkpoint requested an interview with the mayor, who decided to meet us here and turn this into some form of door-to-door campaign. In their smart clothes and fancy cars, the government delegation stood out, attracting onlookers. Shockingly, the mayor says he didn't know this part of Perdekop existed.
It's not suitable for an older person to stay in such a condition. But as the government, we have structures on the ground. We have our ward committees. We have a ward councillor who's supposed to inform us about anything that is happening around here.
To understand the conditions, please go inside one of their homes.
No, it's not a problem.
Let's follow the mayor.
I'll start on Tuesday to deal with this matter, but I can promise it won't take more than 3 months before they have a decent house. Checkpoint, you can come here in 3 months and you'll see development. But now we have done a lot. You can see people, they've got water, they have electricity, and then they'll have a house that will have a toilet inside.
A toilet indoors for the first time in their lives will be a welcome relief. But like millions of South Africans, the electricity they have access to is simply unaffordable. A bittersweet legacy 20 years after freedom.
We're definitely going back to check that the mayor lives up to his promise. Now for our regular feature. Let's see how the rest of the world marked our 20 years of democracy.
It's chilling that the week before South Africa celebrated its 20th birthday as a democracy, Time magazine named public protector Thuli Madonsela as one of the world's 100 most influential people. In the quality US media, South Africa at 20 is seen as a country at a crossroads. There's a recognition that South Africans and their government have made great strides since the end of apartheid. As the Wall Street Journal's Devon Maley wrote on Thursday, 7 million more households have access to electricity compared with two decades ago, access to education has vastly improved, and life expectancy has increased by 8 years in the past 8 years, reflecting progress in healthcare, notably the treatment of HIV/AIDS. At the same time, there's a sense that the gains are in jeopardy unless progress can be made in closing the still yawning gap between haves and have-nots. In the same story, the journal's mainly quoted a recent column by the incoming editor of Business Day, Songezo Zibe. Not only are the streets aflame with angry poor people, but the state's own ability to turn the situation around is severely weakened, Zibe wrote. South Africa stands at a precipice of its own making. More upbeat was a young Wits student, Nkululeko Simelane, born on the first Freedom Day and about to vote for the first time. In a Reuters story featured in the Chicago Tribune, she was quoted as saying, "This apartheid thing, I just don't feel it anymore." To her, wrote reporter Ed Cropley, South Africa was a land of opportunity and potential.
British media has so far focused less on the 20th anniversary than its American counterpart. Financial Times, which has covered the country in a consistent way over decades, published an opinion article by Goldman Sachs' Colin Coleman asking whether South Africa would be able to repeat the Mandela miracle. The Guardian focused on Archbishop Desmond Tutu's call on South Africans to vote with their heads and linked it to his widely publicized statement that he would not vote for the ANC. The newspaper also reported that Jerry Dammers, who made the song Free Nelson Mandela a smash hit in the 1980s, was to receive the Order of O.R. Tambo from President Jacob Zuma in this year's national orders. To capture the way life has changed from the apartheid era, the BBC broadcast a feature about the ease with which racially mixed couples are being accepted as the norm in South Africa. And Reuters gave an insight into the expansive world of the country's born free generation.
That does it for this week's show. As always, we love to hear from you. So visit us on Facebook, send us an email, check out our website. You can also tweet us at checkpoint_ENCA. I'm Nkepile Mabuse. Thanks for watching.